طبعا بقول مساء الخير، اهلا بيكم، مرحبا. وطبعا حاجه جميله ان الواحد يكون في وسطكم، واتمنى ان شاء الله تكون المحاضره لطيفه، ظريفه، عفيفه، شريفه ان شاء الله. يمكن نكون احنا حاليا موجودين في ظروف خاصة جدا، كلنا قاعدين في البيت، ويمكن فرصة جميلة ان احنا قادرين نلتقي كلنا بالمجموعة الكبيرة قوي قوي دي، وقادرين ان احنا الحمد لله نشارك مع بعض في حاجة مش بس تشغل وقتنا، لا تكون مفيدة لينا وللمريض بتاعنا ان شاء الله في المستقبل القريب. موضوع الكورونا دوت قد يكون له بعض الحاجات اللي هي مش جميلة علينا كلنا وعلى بلدنا ولا منطقتنا، إلا إن فعلا لازم نعترف إن برضو له جزء جميل خالص. الجزء الجميل ده أساسه هو العلاقات الجميلة ما بيننا وبين بعضنا. إحنا فرصة جميلة قوي نلتقي النهاردة إن شاء الله، ويمكن أول ما بنلتقي أو نبتدي دايما نقول بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، ونقر حاجة مدركينها مهمة جدا، وما أوتيتم من العلم إلا قليلا. ودليل على كده إن إحنا على مدى السنين اللي فاتت قد يكون الشعر نقول أبيض شوية بعد سن العشرين، إلا إن فعلا الواحد لما بيجي يشوف المحاضرة النهاردة اللي إحنا هنتكلم عنها فانجل رينو ساينوسايتس 2020، والمحاضرة فانجال رينو ساينوسايتس 85 95 2005 2015، حقيقي سبحان العلي العظيم وما أوتيتم من العلم إلا قليلا. وكل ما بنعرف حاجة زيادة، كل ما بنعتقد أو يتهيأ لنا إن إحنا وصلنا للنهاية، أدركنا حقيقي إن إحنا في بداية البداية. وسبحان الله فعلا ان هو اللي هيقدر ان هو يزقنا خطوه خطوه. انا قبل ما ادخل في الموضوع بتاعنا بحب اقول ان الجمعيه المصريه للانف هي جمعيه جميله، لطيفه، ظريفه، عفيفه، شريفه، وهي لها تاريخ جميل. هي تمت 26 سنه فعلا، لكن هي مش 26 سنه حقيقي، ده هي لها تاريخ طويل 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 قبل كده من الثمانينات لما نجحنا نعمل الجمعيه. أنا واجهنا مصاعب كتيرة جدا، كل زملائنا الكبار في السن اللي هو فيه شعرة بيضة في راسه مدرك تماما المجهود الضخم اللي تم من فريق وأعمدة ورجالة وكبار وصغار والرفاعين والتخان بتوع رينو ايجيبت اللي قدروا يحافظوا عليها محافظة عظيمة. وإن شاء الله ربنا يدينا الصحة والعافية وطول العمر إن شاء الله نحافظ عليها مع بعضنا ونورثها، لازم نورثها لناس تستحق انها تشيلها، لان بلدنا بلد جميله، مصر دي بلد جميله تستحق كل الحب وكل التقدير وكل الاحترام. فمش ممكن ابدا ان احنا نعمل هرم رابع اللي هي رينو ايجيبت ونسيبه الا في ايد مجموعه. الواحد حقيقي فخور بوجوده في وسطهم، مجموعه رينو ايجيبت، الناس اللي اكبر مننا اللي بنكن ليهم كل الحب والتقدير والاحترام، الناس اللي هم معانا اللي احنا فعلا بنشتغل ايد في ايد عشان هدف واحد. المجموعه قوة ضربه الشباب بتوعنا الصاعد اللي هو فعلا يشرح القلب الحزين. وطبعا بقى نقول بقى ايه البراعم اللي هي هتفرقع وتطلع، نقول قوة ضربه، والبذور اللي هي هتطرقع وتطلع براعم، وبعدين قوة ضربه، وبعدين قياده، وبعدين رياده. انا سعيد جدا لما اتكلم على تاريخ رينو ايجيبت بكل حب وكل تقدير وكل احترام وكل فخر وكل اعتزاز. مصر بلد جميلة ولازم نكون بنحبها، وأي حد بيحب بلده هيكون بيحب النجاح. اللي عاوز أقوله بان أرب رينولوجي سوسايتي، دي برضو الجمعية اللي هي أكبر من رينو إيجيبت أكيد، وإحنا بنتكلم إن بارس دي بان أرب رينولوجي سوسايتي، إحنا كل سنة بنعمل مؤتمر مرة في القاهرة ومرة في بلد عربي. السنة اللي فاتت اللي قبل اللي فاتت كانت في الجزائر، وبعدين ما شاء الله في رينو إيجيبت السنة دي عملناه في القاهرة. السنة الجاية ربنا يدينا الصحة والعافية والعمر هيكون في الأردن. اتمنى كلنا نكون موجودين مع بعض. الاردن بلد جميله، بلد عظيمه، وحقيقي هم ضيافين وحقيقي حبابين. فان شاء الله يكون السنه الجايه في الاردن ان شاء الله الواحد الاحد. برضو ما بنساش البان عرب جورنال اوف راينولوجي، الباجر. الباجر ده هو الاوفيشال جورنال اوف ذا بارس. وفعلا لما نقول اوفيشال جورنال اوف بارس، احنا النهارده ده السنه العشرة، احنا بنطلع عددين كل سنه، وات از ويل ابريشيتد ناشونالي وريجيونالي وانترناشونالي. فرصه جميله لكل الشباب ان هم فعلا ينشروا في البان عرب جورنال اوف راينولوجي، وفعلا it is a well appreciated journal. اللي بعد كده بقول رينو ايجيبت. رينو ايجيبت برضو ما بنساش رينو ايجيبت. لو ربنا ادينا صحه وعافيه وعمر وشالت البلاء اللي احنا فيه ده ان شاء الله، هيكون اللقاء بتاعنا القادم ان شاء الله في السنه الجايه من 4 ل 6 مارس ان شاء الله، ويكون ان شاء الله لقاء زي ما بيقول دايما لقاءات رينو ايجيبت. كل واحد فينا، كل واحد معانا دلوقتي في اللحظه دي، ان كان من مصر او بره مصر، هو له طوبه في بنيان رينو ايجيبت. اي واحد مننا بيدخل المؤتمر، صغير او كبير، رفيع او تخين، حقيقي بيحس بقد ايه المجهود اللي تم في هذا البناء، وقد ايه النجاح اللي حققه. لما نقول ان السنه دي في اقصى ظروف الظروف، نقول ان حضر اكتر من 2000 دكتور حريص على التواجد، والحمد لله كان كل الحرص في التعاملات، ولم يصاب اي احد الحمد لله باي حاجه مش جميله. اللي عاوز اقوله برضه، لو تلاحظ ان احنا عندنا هنا في لوجو بتاع الجمعيه العالميه للانف، لا انترناشونال راينولوجي سوسايتي، اللي احنا جزء لا نتجزا منه. فاذا الجمعيه دي مجموعه الراينولوجي بتاعت زمان خالص، بتتكون منها نقول جمعية الأنف والجيوب الأنفية المصرية، اللي تكون منها الجمعية العربية للأنف، اللي هي تابعة للجمعية العالمية للأنف. ومصر لها دور سباق، وأنا فخور إن حقيقي معظم المصريين هم يتبعون أصول الصناعة. The state of the art، the consensus paper، the guidelines. وحقيقي إحنا لما بنقول هذا الكلام بكل فخر، على مدى السنين الطويلة العقود السابقة كان في تعليم وتعلم، والحمد لله احنا الشباب بتاعنا شباب جميل. طبعا لما اجي اتكلم على الموضوع، الموضوع بتاعنا هو بنتكلم على حاجة اسمها فانجل رينو سينوسايتس كلاسيفيكيشن اند مانجمنت. قبل ما ابتدي في المحاضرة، بتقدم بالشكر الشديد لدكتور علاء البحيري اللي هو زميل العمر، صديق الكفاح، معايا في الكلية من زمان، والعمدة بتاع كفر الشيخ. وحقيقي دكتور علاء يمكن تكون شايفني، بكني ليك كل الحب والتقدير والاحترام، والدعوة دي دايما بقول فوق راسنا وفي عينينا. وطبعا أنا بقدم موضوع أنا حقيقي ماي فيفورت، يعني هو عبارة عن زي بقول بونبونة، أو عبارة عن هدية لما حد يقول لي تعالى اتكلم على أجمل حاجة تحب تتكلم عنها، هو بيقول لي أتمنى تتكلم على فانجل رينو سينوسايتس. فبكن بكل الاحترام والشكر والتقدير لدعوة الدكتور علاء البحيري، لأن أنا أكون فعلا مستضاف عندكم في المجموعة بتاعتكم اللي هي الرشيقة المجتهدة. وأنا طبعا بتقدم بالشكر لكل الفريق فردا فردا، أنتم مجموعة جميلة حقيقة تستحق كل الاحترام. وأنا طبعا مؤكد أنتم بدايتكم كانت في رينو إيجيبت، واحنا فخورين بيكم، واحنا حريصين على دعمكم دائما، وربنا يوفقكم الى كل خير. دلوقتي معلش المقدمه دي قد تكون طويله شويه، لكن حقيقي الموضوع مش موضوع علم بس، علم وعلاقات. العلاقات ما بيننا اهم حاجه، العلاقات ما بيننا والحب والاخاء، وفعلا رعايه الاصغر سنا واحترام الاكبر سنا، دي سنة علمونا عليها كل الناس الأكبر مننا، وإحنا فعلا الأكبر مننا سنا، واللي ربنا مديلهم الصحة والعافية والعمر ولسه موجودين، كان الدكتور ماجد الشناوي، الدكتور خليفة، الدكتور مجدي حامد، الدكتور ممدوح الجوهري. أتمنى يعني كل الناس دي حقيقي حطوا في قلبنا حقيقي إزاي نحترم الكبير ونحافظ على العلاقة، وزي نحترم الصغير ونحافظ على العلاقة. Fungal Sinusitis Classification and Management. Unfortunately, I just want to tell you bad story. This topic is a relatively difficult topic. Why it is a difficult topic? Because it's a lot of dilemma, a lot of controversy. And regarding the classification and management, unfortunately, of fungal rhinosinusitis, I changed the title to Fungal Rhinosinusitis, the Dilemma. The dilemma, the problem of how to classify and how to manage fungal. Believe me, this is one of the most important clinical topic. I have the experience of more than three decades in fungal rhinosinusitis. Regarding the change in classification, the change in management, and accordingly, I would like to definitely convey to you or transfer to you my experience regarding the fungal rhinosinusitis, the classification and the management. To begin with, the incidence of fungal rhinosinusitis, we have to state it, increasing in number of diagnosed cases of fungal rhinosinusitis. Very strange, increasing. It may be because now we are more aware of the fungal rhinosinusitis existence, classification, and management. Two, is it because of prolonged use of antibiotics? Three, it is because of poor ventilation and air conditioning? Most probably to be. Not only this, dark and moist environments are common happening nowadays. And then the beginning of a lot and increase in the number of immune compromised patients. So the answer is increasing because of a lot of reasons, mainly because of the awareness. I just want to state it from the beginning. It's very important to concentrate on the coming slide. Why? Because we have to understand that although it is one entity of fungal rhinosinusitis, they look similar, but they are quite different. They look similar, why? Because we have to classify the fungal rhinosinusitis according not only tissue invasion, but also according to the immunity of the individual. So tissue invasion, number one, and the immunity, number two, are the two factors, the main factors, according to which we can classify the fungal rhinosinusitis. And accordingly, hop the fungal rhinosinusitis patients may be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or amalgam in between. So accordingly, I just want to make sure that everybody understands that, you see, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 types of fungal rhinosinusitis. So accordingly, you have to, it's your duty, and you are obliged to diagnose which, because the diagnosis of every one of these items or categories or subgroups, it does have its own configuration and it does have its own management. And accordingly, if you failed to diagnose from the start the type of the fungal, you will definitely lose your way, you will get lost. And if we will not be able to offer your patient the state-of-the-art service. So now, according to our Egyptian experience, now we can state it. We have the non-invasive extramucosal. This is outside the mucosa, and we have the invasive. Two big categories. Within the invasive, we have the saprophytic sinusoidal mycosis. We have the fungal bowl. We have the allergic fungal rhinosinusitis. These three are completely extramucosal, but we have the invasive, intramucosal, invading the mucosa, including the acute invasive fungal rhinosinusitis, كرونيك انفيزيف فانجل راينوسينوسايتس، كرونيك جرانيولوماتوس انفيزيف فانجل راينوسينوسايتس. I would like to state it, this the extramucosal non-invasive, the intramucosal invasive, two different categories. And within each category, saprophytic, bowl, allergic fungal, quite different. I just want to give you the color, the white color of the saprophytic. Usually the saprophytic is white color. The fungal bowl, the black color of the fungal bowl. And then for the allergic fungal rhinosinusitis, we have the polyps, the pink or maybe gray, the mucin, the yellow, and then the mud, the brown. And then the invasive form, we have the acute invasive fungal rhinosinusitis, black. The chronic invasive fungal rhinosinusitis, same, black. The chronic granulomatous invasive fungal rhinosinusitis, quite different, red. So this color should be borne in mind, because they will be very helpful for you in the diagnosis of the different groups and subgroups of the fungal rhinosinusitis. So now we can proceed to the host defense. According to the host defense, we can classify the fungal rhinosinusitis to the immune compromised type, the immune competent type, and the atopic or the hyperimmune type. The immune compromised, immune competent, and the hyperimmune. This is the host defense. And then number two, the fungal form, and this is mainly the tissue invasive invasion. So it may be invasive or non-invasive. So the invasive and non-invasive, the invasive form is mainly the invasive acute and invasive chronic. The non-invasive is the saprophytic, the fungal bowl, and the allergic fungal rhinosinusitis. So now we can reach the conclusion. We have the immune compromise, mainly the invasive form, acute. We have the hyperimmune, the allergic fungal sinusitis form. And then the immune competent. The immune competent is basically the fungal bowl, the saprophytic, the invasive chronic, whether it is granulomatous or non-granulomatous. Mind you, this is after Ferguson, 2001. Although it is relatively in the past, but we can understand it. You see here, this small part, this gives you, although at that time, it was stated invasive chronic is basically immune competent, but now you understand that there is some range of immune compromised individuals within this group. So now, and only now we can state it, it's the host defense and the tissue invasion are the two main items or parameters according to which we can classify the fungal rhinosinusitis. Classification. In the year 2007, Stamberger added some modifications. What are these modifications? The first modification is this. Here we are in the non-invasive form. We used to have the saprophytic, the fungal bowl, and the allergic fungal. But scientists began to divide the allergic fungal sinusitis, which is a systemic disease, into the allergic form and the non-allergic form. So in allergic fungal rhinosinusitis, although it is allergic, sometimes it's true allergic atopy, sometimes it's not allergic. So these two entities, although they are similar in everything except the atopy, atopy or no atopy. Two, he added, or the researchers added, the transitional form, which is rare. It was suggested, now it is there, in which the eosinophilic mediated changes into the invasive form. So this is added. And then lastly, he gathered the chronic, indolent, granulomatous. He added both the none and the granulomatous together as one entity. So the classification is a dilemma, but now we understand you have the non-invasive and the invasive and the subgroups. To begin with, the saprophytic sinonasal mycosis. In fact, this entity is not a true disease. This entity is not a true fungal. It's fungal, but usually this diagram, usually give you a beginning of a diagram. What happens? Nothing but a patch of fungal debris colonization, usually white, on top of a crust, on top of a turbinate. In most of the cases, it's a post-operative. And this is a typical case after surgery. One of the crusts here, and you see the fungal colonization. And here we are. The symptoms, in most of the cases, nothing is symptomatic. Crusting, understood. Odor may be bad. In most of the cases, it's after surgery. Endoscopy, fungal spores on crusts after surgery. Their treatment is nothing. With the endoscope in the outpatient clinic, we can remove the crusts. We can advise the patient for saline irrigation. We can ask the patient to take mucolytics. It's a simple happening. So the saprophytic sinonasal mycosis is a very simple form of fungal, and it's added to the fungal rhinosinusitis just not to miss such a form. So now we come to the second form. The second form is the fungal ball. Again, mind you, the fungal ball is non-invasive. Non-invasive. It's an extra mucosal. And now I just want to give you a diagram. So the diagram gives you, to begin with, once upon a time, it was named mycetoma. Not anymore. Mycetoma is a misnomer. We should not say that this is a mycetoma. This is a fungal ball. Mycetoma means a mess, means invasion, which is not the case. I'm going to show you when do we can say that this is a mycetoma. So this is a fungal ball within one of the big sinuses, the maxillary. And here we are. The symptoms are usually asymptomatic. And in most of the cases, nothing. But the patient is suffering from recurrent acute sinusitis on, off, on, off, on, off. And the patient usually definitely takes antibiotic, decongestant, mucolytics, saline with no response, on, off. In most of the cases, we can identify a previous dental work. A previous dental work, 90% in the cases, but we may miss it. Why? Because it may occur years and years and years after the previous endo dental treatment. Why? Maybe because certain components of the sealers used in the endodontal treatment, like zinc oxide, may promote the fungal growth. So that's why the dental work, endodontal work, may invite the fungal infection, a fungal ball. Endoscopy, in most of the cases, is non-specific. CT, usually one sinus. Most of the cases, maxillary, more than 90%. Sphenoid, although the literature states that maxillary sinus is more than 90%, but in our experience, we may state it, the maxillary is more than the sphenoid, but the incidence of sphenoid fungal bore may be more than 30% in our region. So now the CT. The CT is very pathognomonic. Why? Unilateral disease, big sinus, maxillary or sphenoid, intra-lesional hyperdensity, you see the hyperdensity, or calcification within an opacified unilateral sinus, typical, looks as if like a pellet, which is not the case, it's a fungal. And now, just to show you, a CT of the sphenoid, The sphenoid sinus, we usually have sphenoid sinus, but can we notice the left side and right side? The left side, no fungus. The right side, you see the opacity, the fungal debris. But what is very characteristic is the sphenoid, the hyperostosis or the thickening of the walls of the sinus, thickening the wall thick, hyperdensity of the wall, but intact. Be careful, it's an intact wall. We understand that here we are, the optic nerve, and the V2. And here we are, this is a hyperdensity of the thickened wall at the neo. In the MRI, we can notice here the thickening of the lining of the sinus with the void area, because of the metallic contents of the fungus. This is a very characteristic happening in the fungal bowl. So now we can shift another case clear. Now we can state it left fungal. Why? Intact wall, thickened wall, opacity. Axial, intact wall, thickened wall, opacity, complete opacity. So now we can state it that you have to make sure that all the walls are intact. Here we are. This is a very strange case. Why a very strange case? Because here we are. We have here not only maxillary fungal bowl, but also sphenoid sinus fungal bowl. The same patient, you see, same date. So usually don't leave or allow to leave the name of the patient, but here just to show you, this is the same case. So we had to manage the maxillary sinus fungal bowl and the sphenoid sinus fungal bowl. My new very nice CT showing the optic, the V2, and the Vidian and the palatovaginal canal for your interest. So now, histopathology, we have to state it, no tissue invasion, extramucosal, dense mat of fungal hyphae, dense mat, no eosinophilic mucin. Oh, no eosinophilic mucin. Why? To define that it is not allergic fungal. Then in 90%, it's aspergillosis. For the culture, unreliable in most of the cases. But for the histopathology, we can identify the aspergillosis within the tissue. It's nothing but fungus. Treatment is nothing. Are we going to handle such a case medically? No. Always transnasal endoscopic removal of the fungal bowl. What we usually do is to perform a wide ostium. If the maxillary sinus is involved, usually we perform a wide middle meter antrostomy. If the sphenoid sinus is involved, usually we perform wide sphenoidotomy. And the aim of work of performing a wide opening for the sinus is to offer proper delivery of the mass for irrigation, and definitely to decrease the incidence of recurrence, aeration, and the drainage, and the proper follow-up. We can use our angle telescope to monitor any recurrence. And if any recurrence happened, we can irrigate, and irrigate again. Mind you, one of the most important rules is don't touch the integrity of the mucosa. Don't insult the mucosa. Leave the mucosa in peace. May induce tissue invasion. So we have to be very careful. We remove the fungus, irrigate, and stop it. Here we are. One of the cases you see typical, this is the fungal bowl. And here we are. Hopefully this is working. Here we are. This is, as we can notice here, this is the middle meter antrostomy. And we can notice here that the fungal bowl is sucked from the right maxillary sinus. We are sucking the secretions. We are sucking the secretions. We are delivering the fungal. It's nothing but fungal debris. we can deliver that fungal debris using our curved tool. Whatsoever you see, we fracture it or divide it into pieces, and then we remove it under endoscopic control, piecemeal. You see nothing but fungal. It's a ball of fungal. We have to have a relatively wide millimeter, and trust me, to be able, you see, it's a fungal, black, brown, and that's it, what we usually do in, it's easy. And here we are, we can state it, that this is one of the cases where we have here, you see, unilateral left side, the typical, here we are, typical, you see, opacity of one sinus, and hyperdensity because of the fungal debris. And this is a post-operative finding. You see, the mucosa is healthy. And the millimeter antrostomy is opened. Ethmoid was not done. Just we did millimeter antrostomy, we cleared it. So usually this is a summarize for a fungal ball. The immunity is competent. The site, maxillary or sphenoid, hardly ever frontal and or the ethmoid. The cause, aspergillosis, endodontal treatment. Symptoms, mainly discharge, postnasal drip, as if it were recurrent acute maxillary sinusitis. Signs may be mucoperitoneal discharge, not pathognomonic. The CT is very, very pathognomonic. The treatment, mainly surgical. No need for any medical therapy except after surgery, saline, nothing else. Good prognosis, uncommon recurrence at all. Usually you don't face any recurrence. Is there a good reason to offer the patient any antifungal therapy? Never, never, and never again. Neither local nor systemic. So now we can shift to the next group. The next group is basically the allergic fungal rhinosinusitis, which is the most common. This is the most common form of, so again, the diagram. The diagram shows us number one, hop, unilateral hop polyps, the pink or gray polyps. Not only the pink or gray polyps, but also we have the fungal debris and we have the fungal mucin. The yellow mucin and the brown fungal debris. And according to the triad, the polyps, mud, and mucin, usually this triad usually gives you the criteria or the parameters or the direction, or you can just suggest or suspect that this is a case of allergic fungal rhinosinusitis. Major criteria, Bent and Kuhn were one of the first group that definitely put a very clear criteria for the allergic fungal rhinosinusitis. Beginning by the polyps, so you have to have polyps. Usually this is, can be achieved by endoscopy. You have to have eosinophilic mucin. Usually the eosinophilic mucin is achieved by the histopathology. CT shows serpiginous areas of high attenuation, the double density. And then fungal, you have to identify the fungus either in the stain, in the histopathology, or in the culture, which is a relatively difficult task in a lot of cases. And number five, the atopy, mainly number type one, hypersensitivity to fungi. And how to identify the hypersensitivity? Usually we depend on the skin test, the IgE, which is usually high, and maybe if you fail to identify it from the IgE and or the skin test, you can result to a history which is highly suggestive of allergy. Now we can go. This is the major criteria. The major criteria are here. So the minor criteria, we have other minor criteria, including the unilaterality, the asthma, and then the expansion, the bone expansion, and then the different eosinophilia, and then the chart would call, we are going to show you this in the histopathology. Allergic fungal rhinosinusitis, usually young patient, symptoms usually unilateral, mainly obstruction, discharge, the secretions are usually thick, tenacious, and proptosis. Are you? طب احنا نخلص خالص في الاخر ونشغل الفيديوز. انا فهمت ان الفيديو ما اشتغلش كما يجب ان يكون، يبقى احنا هنقدر ان احنا نشغله من المين سورس بتاعه. طيب هو يبدو ان الفيديو في بعض المشاكل. لو يا عمر طب احنا خلينا نكمل المحاضره للاخر بالظبط كده. هو بس نطمن بس ان فعلا دوت كده احنا في ال كده سلايد عندك جاي باين عندك دلوقتي سلايد كده. No problem whatsoever. احنا بس نكمل اللي هو الايه المحاضرة وبعدين ممكن بعد كده نعمل كل الفيديوز مع بعض. ده الفانجل بول، احنا الصورة واضحة عندك كده عمر؟ So I'm very sorry for the video. Now we can state that these are the minor criteria. And we understand that the symptoms include the unilateral obstruction, discharge secretions, thick tenacious, dark mucus. It's very thick, very thick. Hopefully, inshallah, in the, at the end of the story, we can show you the video. Endoscopy may be unilateral, including edema polyps, mud, and the mucine. The polyps usually gray or pink. The mucine, yellow, the mud, brown. And then we can proceed. The CT is very, very characteristic, showing the pseudomucocele. You see the bulging. But what's very important is the double density, hyper dense and low dense, hyper dense, low dense, usually in the soft tissue cut. So we usually ask for the bony window and the soft tissue cut window as well. And here we are, the double density sign because of the thick fungal mucine, heavy metal deposits surrounded by, this is a metal deposit surrounded by the hyperplastic nasal mucosa or hyperplastic maxillary sinus mucosa. This is because the double density sign, the hyper density, the metallic dense shadow. And now again, as you can notice, usually the allergic fungal sinusitis form invades the brain, invades the orbit if it is a late diagnosis. But we have to state it, although it is intracranial, I'm going to show you the MRI is very important in such a case. The MRI should be performed in such a case. And here we are, it's an intraorbital and the subcutaneous as well because of the late diagnosis. And definitely this is a case of proptosis. The CT is very pathognomonic. The MRI as well, the enhancement periphery, but in the T2, we can notice, you see the metallic dense shadow. This gives you the impression as if it were bone. This is not bone. It is because of the lack of water. This means that you have very, very, very tough fungal debris, and you will use a lot of irrigation, irrigation, and irrigation again. So this is a pathognomonic, the void area in the T2 and the peripheral enhancement in T1 with enhancement. Here we are again, you see the void area in the MRI. You see how expansile the mass is. This Hussein, many years now, he is grown up, married, children, and here we are, you see the follow-up, you see aggressive pressing on both orbital apex. Here we are, the soft tissue cut shows how aggressive the lesion is, the pseudo nicosil. And here we are, the proptosis because of the push of the eye. Although it's intraorbital, it's extra periorbital, and intracranial, extra dural. And here we are, you see here again, the void area. This is not bone. It is because of very tough fungal debris. Allergic fungal sinusitis, it's not a true fungal infection. The pathogenesis should be understood, but unfortunately, we don't have a definite theory. It's a reaction to fungal antigen. And accordingly, we have type 1 hypersensitivity, IgE mediated. Well, accordingly, histamine, inflammatory mediators, and eosinophils are there. That's the secret of eosinophilia. And type 3 hypersensitivity, IgG mediated antigen antibody complex formation, immune complex deposition, and inflammation. Unfortunately, this is a suggestion, but this is the basics of allergic rhinosinusitis. Unfortunately, sometimes allergic fungal sinusitis is eosinophilic mediated fungal rhinosinusitis, not allergic. That's why you see the statement here by my and his colleagues. Here we are, the eosinophilic mucine rhinosinusitis. Whenever you find mucine, it is called eosinophilic mucine rhinosinusitis. The fungus, if there is fungus, it is eosinophilic fungal rhinosinusitis. If it is no fungus, eosinophilic fungal rhinosinusitis like syndrome. If it is eosinophilic fungal, this is the case we are dealing with. It may be either atopic or no atopy, allergy or no allergy. If allergy, it's allergic fungal rhinosinusitis. If it is no allergy, non-allergic fungal rhinosinusitis. So it's a debate, but anyhow, similar. Allergy immunology, peripheral blood eosinophilia, immediate skin test reactivity, very helpful. Elevated total serum IgE, more than 1,000, very pathognomonic, and pathognomonic of the improvement as well. Precipitating antibodies of offending fungal antigen, elevated specific fungal IgE and IgG. Mind you, we have to make sure that the patient is immune competent based on humoral and cellular screening. So we have to state it, allergic fungal sinusitis is a very specific and is a very peculiar type of allergic of the fungal rhinosinusitis. Histopathology and mycology. For the histopathology, we use the PAS, PAS and GMS. And here we are, for the histopathology, allergic mucine is there. It is composed of scattered fungal hyphae, abundant eosinophils, Charcot-laden crystals. The Charcot-laden crystals, nothing but byproducts of the eosinophilic granules. And all of these are located within mucinous tissue. And then here are the mycology is basically aspergillosis. Basically aspergillosis, maybe alternaria, bipolaris, or others, but it's basically aspergillosis. So now we can shift. Here I just want to show you, this is a case of AFS with intact sinusal framework, but it may begin to invade the orbit. Here we are invading the orbit, invading the brain as well. Invading here, you see the bulging, the pseudo mucosal, you see bulging in the cheek as well. It is not a mucosal, it is involving, including the fungal debris. And here we are intracranial, intraorbital, extradural, extrapreorbital. And here we are void areas. And here void areas, the remodeling of the skull base, remodeling of the lamina papyracea is because of the toxic effect of locally released inflammatory mediators, basically major basic protein. It's a pressure necrosis, but still the dura and the periorbita are intact. Here we are. We have here, you see this is a pseudomucosal as well, although it was very far, but here we are very far and very, very aggressive. But you see irrigation, and you see the bulge of the anterior wall, the bulge, no previous operation, very strange. And you see here the T2 showing the void area. So we can understand this case is for surgery, definitely. Extra sinusitis framework extension, aggressive behavior, still extra mucosal, orbit, cranial cavity, sublabial or infratemporal fossa. So the message is, hopefully the video will be shown later on, but here we are. We can aggressive behavior, but still extra mucosal, non-invasive. The intraorbital extension, it is extra periorbital. The periorbital is intact. And intracranial, extra dural, the dura is intact. Why we said this? Because during maneuver, so the hydrosuction, the irrigation and suction, wash, saline irrigation will offer you dislodgement of, of this issue. Hopefully everybody is following. أنا عاوز أطمن يا ترى في خمول؟ نو خمول، في خمول؟ طب يا ترى في دمور؟ نو دمور. Avoid sharp dissection. Why do we avoid sharp dissection? To avoid insult to the dura or the periorbita. This may invite intracranial and intraorbital, unfortunately, the extra mucosal intracranial and intraorbital involvement. And this is very bad if you inserted the periorbita. The video will be shown at the end, but I just want to show you this one of the cases. You see here the sphenoid sinus, the optic nerve, the carotid artery. You see the fungal tissue is within the OCR, optico carotid recess. And here we are, the irrigation. Unfortunately, I'm going to show you the video clips at the end. I just want to show you this. You see here we are using the navigation. You see we are intracranial, yes, because the bulge of the lesion. We are intracranial, yes, you see here the skull base, but this is the bulge of the lesion, irrigation. And here we are, you see here, far lateral to the optic nerve. And that's why we have to be very careful. Sharp dissection may invite extramucosal, intracranial, intraorbital. So this is very serious. Or change the allergic fungal form into the granulomatous form. I'm going to show you one of these cases. Complete surgical debridement is basically, and the drainage, and then we usually resort to the medical therapy. Do we perform medical therapy beginning? We can begin before surgery, but basically we do our best to get rid of the fungal burden, the volume, the fungal volume, and then we can take care of the residual by the medical therapy. Here we are, this is one of the cases. The video will be shown at the end of the story, but this is before surgery and this is after surgery. And then here we are, the complete surgical debridement and the drainage. What we usually do? Usually, we tailor our surgery according to the state of the patient. Endoscopy, CT, MRI, intraoperative. We do pulpectomy. We use usually our shaver. And then the middle meter antrostomy. We usually perform very wide middle meter antrostomy. And sometimes we perform partial middle maxillectomy. Very wide. And maxillary sinus clearance. We irrigate, and deliver the mucine and mud and polyps. And then we can perform ethmoidectomy. In most of the cases, we perform complete ethmoidectomy, anterior and posterior, keeping the integrity of the skull base and the orbit, And then the sphenoidotomy, marsupialization, sphenoid sinus clearance, you remove all, and we keep the integrity of the mucosa. And usually we perform a very wide opening. We usually go transnasal endoscopic too, if it is only the sphenoid sinus. But in most of the cases, we go transethmoid because affection of more than one sinus. The frontal recess clearance, frontal ostium cannulation, natural and wide. We have to state it that we usually identify the frontal ostium already natural frontal sinusotomy. The fungal debris usually widens the ostium, the opening of the sinus ostium. And then we irrigate, and get rid of the fungal debris. Video again related to the end. The complete surgical debridement, the extent, here we are. We preserve the mucosa. We don't remove the mucosa. I just want to show you this. You see, this is one of the cases. You see, partial medial maxillectomy. And here we are. Although we offered very wide opening for aeration and drainage, but you see here, we have thickened mucosa. So it seems it's not a cure of disease. And here we are, although we have very nice wide millimeter antrostomy, partial medial maxillectomy, but still the mucosa is unhealthy. It is a systemic disease. So that's why you understand that it's a medical disease. Surgery is supplementary or adjuvant, and the pre and post operative medical therapy is a must, and steroid therapy is the mainstay. And here we are. Again, the mucosa. You see the mucosa, how unhealthy the mucosa is, how unhealthy the optic nerve, the carotid. And here we are. We have to make sure that this is the postoperative. So we understand that we have to offer this patient systemic or local steroid. I'm going to share. Steroid. Steroid is a very important and mainstay in the management of allergic fungal rhinosinusitis. The role of steroids, suppression of the level of inflammatory response, eosinophilia, and usually decrease in the IgE. So steroid, very important. The regime that of, are we going to use a short burst, relatively high dose, short time, or prolonged time and very small dose? This is, you see, controversy. But we usually resort to the short burst, 2-3, maximum 4 times a year. So now we can go systemic steroid. There is no dictum, but maybe 0.5 milligram per kg per day for 2 weeks, and then gradual withdrawal. Sometimes they state 2 to 5 milligrams every other day for a long time, but usually we resort to this for a very short time. Local, after endoscopic assurance, of good mucociliary clearance. After we make sure that the cavity is good, surgery, and then the systemic steroid, then we resort to the local application, pre and post operative. Antifungal agents, a big debate. In fact, we don't use it. Systemic, are we going to use intravenous? Never. Oral, ever. Local, maybe. Very rare. The rationale of using an antifungal is to reduce the fungal load, according to reduce the immune response. But we have to state, allergic fungal rhinosinusitis is basically not a fungal infection. It's a reaction to the fungal debris. So the use of an antifungal agent in a non-invasive form, we have to be very cautious. We don't use it except. We may use a local application. Systemic amphotericin B, keto or itraconazole, no, we don't use this at all, especially. And then local, we can use local extramucosal, local amphotericin B, but if we are going to use the local amphotericin B, we use 50 milligram and dilute it in 1,000 milliliter of distilled water for irrigation. We don't dilute it neither in dextrose or in saline. Saline destroys the amphotericin B, the amphangazone. And dextrose is used whenever you are going to use it intravenous, never in allergic fungal sinusitis. And according 20 milliliters each nostril for 5 times a day. This, but hardly ever we use it except in resistant cases. Immunotherapy is very effective. Number one, we can prove that this case is atopic. We can understand that the patient is atopic. The type of atopy, how dust mite, fungi, dander, or the pollens. So we have to make sure that the cause of allergy, حبوب اللقاح, فطريات, حشرات, اتت فرش, either dander, the cat or dog or feather. So accordingly, the avoidance is very important. And the use of the immunotherapy as shots should be at least for 5 years, not 3 years as conventional immunotherapy. Decreased the need for systemic steroids and definitely decreases the need for a revision surgery. So immunotherapy should be performed by an expert team because of the possibility of any reaction. Then the leukotriene modulators. The leukotriene modulators, you see, there is, I don't want to say a debate. There is no good evidence to support this. And then we come to the new point, the biologics. The biologic therapy used in refractory asthma, we understand it is used. Suggested in chronic rhinosinusitis with nasal polyps. And we understand omalizumab and the mepolizumab are used as biologic for the asthma. They are suppressing the inflammatory mediators, including the anti-IgE and anti-interleukin-5 agents. There is a study stating that there is an improvement in the SNOT 22, 30%, as well as endoscopic score in 60%. But we understand that the cost, very important to be considered, the cost, the benefit, the long-term side effects should be borne in mind. It's an expensive drug. The benefits should be against the benefit for allergic fungal rhinosinusitis. It's not a resistant asthma. And then the long-term side effects, we have to expect it. We don't have long-term follow-up of these patients. So this is the post-operative. Again, you see the mucosa is not very, very healthy. So one should be careful. Are we curing this case or controlling? It's a control. The recurrence is there. So you have to put in mind the recurrence is there. And then the remission and exacerbations, we have to expect it and be ready. You see here for a remission and exacerbation, we understand this may be for irrigation. This may be for the systemic. We understand that the cortisone wash now is approved, but it's not an FDA approved, but we can use it, the high dose, the high volume, the high pressure to irrigate the palmy cord in saline. And then we can use it as a post-operative care of the patient. Now, in conclusion, for the allergic fungal sinusitis, again, the table, immunity, allergy, it's hyperimmune, atopy, the site, ethmoid, mainly maxillary, sphenoid, frontal, all the sinuses, nose. The cause, allergy, atopy, may be symptoms, obstruction, unilateral usually, discharge, mucine, proptosis, a common happening, unilateral. Signs, polyps, unilateral, discharge, mucine, and mud. The polyps, mud, and mucine. Investigation, the CT, very pathognomonic. Endoscopy, skin test, biopsy, culture, stain, eosinophilia. and then treatment mainly fast and destroyed. The prognosis, it's a control. Recurrence is a common happening. So we have to inform our patient of the possibility of recurrence, and he or she has to follow up. Now we come to the next point. The next point regarding the acute invasive fungal rhinosinusitis, the fulminant, we don't use nowadays the fulminant. Here we are, the fulminant. And again, I remind you, the black. So this form is increasing. Why is it increasing? I'm going to tell you this. So what we usually have, hop, black, mid-thermal, and then hop, black, inferior thermal, and hop, black, ethmoid area, and hop, intraorbital and intracranial, and suddenly, in no time, less than 4 weeks, maybe days, maybe hours, and then hop, 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 dead, very rapid. The incidence of death is very high. So one should be careful. You have to diagnose the case early, early, within the sinonasal framework. When it begins to invade the orbit and the brain, usually it's a dead duck. Unfortunately, the patient is lost very rapid, very rapid. Acute fulminant, less than 4 weeks, immune compromised. You see here the immunity. Early diagnosis is the key. Hours count. Aggressive, it's a fatal disease, 50 to 80% fatal. If the underlying cause is not controlled, the patient is going to die. So you have to be ready and aware. So now the immune compromised status, including diabetes, a lot of causes, mainly diabetes mellitus, the ketoacidosis, the transplanted patients, corticosteroid and immune suppression, the cytotoxic drugs, the irradiation, the renal failure, and a lot of immune suppressed cases. And accordingly, these cases are prone for the acute fulminant fungal rhinosinusitis. And unfortunately, most of these cases are handled by other subspecialties. That's why we have to have very good communication with the subspecialties dealing with these patients. Accordingly, the prognosis, better prognosis in diabetic ketoacidosis. Why? Because in most of the cases, we can rapidly control the acidosis. But the poor prognosis goes with the old case, old patient, the aplastic anemia, delayed diagnosis, concurrent hepatorenal failure, the intracranial complication, and the neutropenia. These are bad parameters for the patient is going to have very bad prognosis. The death is very high, more than 90%. The pathogenesis, it's not mere colonization at all. The invasion of the neurovascular bundles, the neurovascular and the coronary thrombosis, intravascular thrombosis, local and or distant ischemia, necrosis, and the coronary spread outside the vicinity of the sinuses into the surrounding cavities, including definitely via the bone, the orbit, the brain, subcutaneous and infratemporal fossa. Unfortunately, this is a late diagnosis. The definition, we can put the definition of allergic, of the acute invasive fungal rhinosinusitis, the presence of fungal hyphae within the sinonasal mucosa, submucosal, vasculature, nerves and bone in the setting of 1 month or even less of sinus. Unfortunately, the symptoms I'm going to show you, this aspergillus species and zygomycetes, basically mucormycosis. So it's not only mucor. Once upon a time it was called mucormycosis, but not anymore. It's acute invasive fungal rhinosinusitis. Symptoms, mainly pain, fever, and headache. So we have to state it, pain, fever, and headache in an immune-compromised individual gives you the very, very, very good clue that this is acute invasive fungal rhinosinusitis until proved otherwise. And then it goes outside. Early diagnosis here, but then later rapidly. So according the numbness, the facial swelling and erythema early, but proptosis, diplopia, visual loss, headache, neurological deficit, third, fourth, and sixth, the orbital apex and the cavernous sinus. So the clue is the pain, fever, and headache in immune compromised individual is a big suspicion of acute invasive fungal rhinosinusitis. So doctors dealing with the diabetic, the renal, the hepatic, the cancer, and autoimmune, and these doctors should be aware of this. And I'm going to show you the mucosa. The mucosa begins pale and edematous, pale and edematous. Then darker, avascular. Then black and necrotic. Then ulceration and slough. And lastly, very thick crust and ichor. Here we are. The mucosa is changing according to the blood supply and then the septal perforation. The early, the CT, unfortunately, shows nothing. Minimal pathology. I'm going to show you this. Late significant. So it either or. Very early, very good prognosis. Late, and the difference may be days. The difference may be hours. The early diagnosis. The MRI shows the orbit and the brain and the extra sinusoidal framework. Now to us, assess the immunity. Complete blood picture should be done. Blood chemistry, liver function, autoimmune enzymes, energy panels for the cellular and humoral immunity, HIV, and so on. All this to show you the reason behind being insulted by such a bad disease. Biopsy shows tissue invasion by fungal hyphae. Mycology, mucor, mainly, but aspergillosis is there. Now it's not a mucormycosis anymore. Biopsy, tissue invasion, basically. Fungal hyphae, basically. Either mucor or aspergillus. Mucor, large, you see, he is small. Irregular, shaped, here we are, uniform diameter. And then non-septate hyphae, Branch at right angle. Here the branching at 45 degree. Here we are, you see the mucor, here we are, and this is the aspergillosis. So very clear and very clear. And usually we use the PS and methylene silver staining, MSS, and here we are, this is for the aspergillosis and mucor. Hematoxylin and eosin is good as well, but you see the histopathology is very important. Why? Because in the management, in the medical management, it's quite different for the mucor and for the aspergillosis. And then the treatment, basically prognosis is borne in mind. We correct the underlying metabolic immunologic derangement. And we have to correct the diabetic status. That's why you see the diabetes usually does have very good prognosis. Why? Because we can rapidly correct the ketoacidosis. But others, renal, kidney, cancer, other autoimmune, bad prognosis. Intravisa antifungal, mainly amphotericin B or the Vifend, based on, I'm going to show you this, wide local resection of all involved and devitalized nasal, sinus, oral, orbital, and everything. You have to remove all the necrotic tissue. The other measures may be hyperbaric oxygen. There is no good clue, but you see, may help. Surgical debridement, endoscopic. We usually avoid open approaches, very bad prognosis, very bad results. Orbital excentration, we don't perform orbital excentration except in non-functioning eye. Complete resection of necrotic tissue. Unfortunately, open surgery, the craniofacial and the maxillectomy, they disfigure me. And very bad prognosis. And usually we remove, resect until healthy bleeding tissue. The video may show you this. Urgent or delayed. Are you going to perform surgery immediately or we are going to delay it until we can control the condition behind? Usually we advise we delay surgery 1 or 2 days because the patient either is going to die or the patient will definitely improve general status and we can definitely shift to surgery safely. Surgical debridement. endoscopic removal of all large amount of the nasal mucosa affected. Gangrene, the turbinates, gangrene, extended fist gangrene, medial maxillectomy gangrene, and draft 3 may be resorted to. So it's a very wide, we remove all the necrotic tissue. But whenever it goes to the orbit, whenever it goes to the brain, this is the duck medical. The multidisciplinary, usually a lot of the specialties, medical, those dealing with the diabetes, with the hematology, surgical, ENT, maxillofacial, neurosurgery, ophthalmology, histopathology, microbiology. So a lot of subspecialties should be working together, especially if you are going to give the antifungal therapy early. You see, if you could diagnose a case like this, what is here? Nothing but pale mucosa. What's here? Nothing. Itis? No, this is the beginning. Immune compromised individual, pale mucosa. And here we are, you see, excision of the middle turbinate and finished. The patient was saved. Here we are again, you see the beginning of the pallor and the discolored and yellow color. And you see here we are, maybe a defect up there. This may suggest the reason of death in a lot of cases. And here we are, you see here, the early head is still no intracranial and no intraorbital extension. And here we are, this is one of the cases, intraorbital. And here we are, the video I'm going to show you at the end, hopefully it will be working. And then you see late, whenever you see the black color of the inferior turbinate. And here we are, you see it's a dead duck. You see too late, you see the orbit and the skin here. This means that you see thrombosis into the infraorbital artery and nerve. And here we are, this is one of the cases. You see this eye already complete. You see ophthalmoplegia and blindness. You see here, it is a very aggressive lesion involving the orbital apex. And here we are, you see nothing in the nose limited, just edema and pallor. And this is unfortunately too late. This case came to our hospital and unfortunately it was too late and died despite, you see this, she died on table before being touched, before being anesthetized at all. You see here, although it looks as if it were a minimal pathology, but we understand distant thrombosis and death. So the clue is very early diagnosis. The clue is where you see here, the enhancement shows you see the thrombosis inside the blood vessel. And here you see here the air within the orbit, which is very bad. The antifungal therapy, early fungal culture, very important because the amphotericin B is effective against the mucormycosis and aspergillus, but mainly mucor. The liposomal type of the amphotericin B is less nephrotoxic, maybe more expensive. The varicoconazole, the Vifend, for aspergillosis only, we can't use the Vifend for the mucor. So it's very important to, how long? Long time, weeks, months, until we control the disease. I don't want to go into the details of how do we give, but you see, the very important part of the story is that we dilute the antifungal amphotericin B in dextrose, not in saline. And usually we cover it by silver paper. Why? Because it is affected by light. And if it is diluted in saline, it will lose all effectivity. And usually we send this patient, we don't give this medication. Usually we send that patient for the nephrology team. It's nephrotoxic, it's toxic, bone marrow suppression, and autotoxic as well. So we have to be careful. And these patients, the early diagnosis. So in conclusion, the acute invasive fungal rhinosinusitis fulminant, the immune compromised individual. This is very important. The site, any site with extra sinonasal framework, the cause mucor, aspergillosis, the symptoms, pain, fever, and headache early, and then extra sinusoidal framework. The signs, basically the black debris, the edema, the yellow, the necrosis, and the sloughing, and the crusting, investigate the CT, endoscopy, and biopsy. Treatment, antifungal, debridement, and we have to control and control and control the cause of the immune compromised status. Otherwise, we will definitely fail. And then the prognosis, very bad, lethal, and very short time, less than 4 weeks. So now we can go to the chronic invasive fungal. I have to confess that this type of fungal, Rhinosinusitis, I don't have the experience and I did not notice many cases of this. It's the same, exactly the same, exactly the same, exactly like acute invasive fungal rhinosinusitis. But the only difference is the immune compromised status or the immune competent status and the period. So accordingly, the chronic invasive fungal rhinosinusitis, which are not a common happening in our region, is more frequent in the immune competent. You see, it's immune competent. Much more chronic path, months or years, the other one, weeks or days or hours. It's mistaken for malignancy. Similar in everything to the acute invasive fungal rhinosinusitis, aspergillosis and mucor. The most important part of the story is the early diagnosis. Mind you, mainly it's immune competent. Here we are. Unfortunately, insidious, its symptoms very minimal. Bloody nasal discharge, unilateral nasal obstruction, bad odor. The mass in the nasal cavity may be blackish or the sinuses. Invasion of the orbit, again, apoptosis, maxillary sinus, skin affection, or may extend to the anterior cranial fossa and neurological symptoms. So it's exactly like the acute fulminant, but it's chronic indolent. It is usually very slow, but the same pathology. The same pathology is done, one difference. The CT with contrast, bony destruction and hyper attenuation. The MRI with contrast, deeper invasion, meningeal enhancement and cavernous sinus involvement. The pathology similar to the acute invasive with one difference. Lower inflammation response, less dense population of inflammatory cells. Why? Because it's a slow disease, not like the acute fulminant. The treatment basically the same, debridement and antifungal. So now we come to the last entity. I'm sorry for the fi khumul. No khumul. في دمور نكمل ولا the idea is now chronic granulomatous invasive fungal rhinosinusitis indolent. Here we are. This is usually the case, a mass, big mass, and then bigger mass, and then bigger mass, unfortunately, months, years, and then very big mass, months, year. Unfortunately, whenever it invades the orbit and or the brain, this is a very bad story. And here we are at the end, hop, dead, but unfortunately, very slow. These patients are unlucky patients. These patients are very unlucky, very, very unlucky patients. And accordingly, here we are. The chronic indolent is rare, infrequently in Western country. In Western country, they don't have experience at all with these cases. It's more common in North Africa, in our region, in the Middle East and Asia. Immune competent basically may be immune compressed or suppressed. Occasionally, coexist with other forms of fungal. I'm going to show you this. Typically, aspergillus. So now we understand the medical therapy. And then histological, non-caseating granuloma. It's a granuloma, red granuloma. And here we are. The symptoms, headache, nasal obstruction, and then extension, extra sinonasal, orbit, cranial, brain, cheek, palate, very slow, unfortunately. If you could not identify it early, unfortunately, the patient is a dead duck. Here we are. here are friable granulation tissue bleeding easily, and I'm going to show you one of the videos later. Here we are, we can note that it's intraorbital, intraperiorbital, and intradural, intracranial. And here we are with contrast, you see it is an enhanceable tissue, all in all. And here we are, we have to be careful of this. You see intracranial involvement. This is very, very aggressive lesion. Intraorbital, intraperiorbital, intracranial, intradural. Here we are again, the MRI shows you see how aggressive the lesion may be. Significant soft tissue thickening and altered adjacent bone. MRI, impending orbital and the cranial cavity invasion. So biopsy, tissue invasion by fungal hyphae, mycology, mini aspergillosis. The treatment, wide local resection, endoscopic basically, transnasal, and avoid external approach at all. And then the systemic antifungal. Are we going to give the patient amphotericin B fungazone? Never. Defend the voriconazole. And here we are, this is, you see the case, the video, maybe later. And here we are, this is one of the aggressive cases. Can you see how the optic nerve was involved and the vision was involved and the field was involved? Here we are. This is, you see, the optic nerve was, you see, encroached upon. And accordingly, here we are, you see the carotid artery, you see as well. So accordingly, what we did here, this is, you see, before surgery and this is after surgery. Happily, we could control that case and that case survived the post-operative medical therapy and the patient survived after surgery. Unfortunately, some patients come with this, you see blindness, but proptosis asking for after control of the disease for cosmetic. And in such a cases, we can resort to the external approach after making sure of the control of the disease. And this is usually the case with the ophthalmology team, Too late. So, and we have to make sure that treatment recurrence is there. The residual is the basic, unfortunately, situation. I just want to show you this. This is one of the cases, Sudanese patient, where one of the doctors took care of allergic fungal sinusitis case via a sublabial incision and called the look. And he invited the infection outside the subcutaneous tissue and unfortunately avoid external approach in the allergic fungal sinusitis, invites extra sinusoidal extension. And this is the mycetoma or the fungoma. This is sublabial and very, very tough and adherent to the bone, adherent to the cartilage, adherent to everything. In conclusion, the inland fungal sinusitis, you see immune competent, may be hyper immune compromised. Basically the site ethmoid and then grows. Aspergillosis, symptoms basically obstruction unilateral. Then signs nasal mass, unilateral, extra sinonasal, investigations, CT, endoscopy, and biopsy. The treatment, antifungal, and debridement, and the prognosis is relatively bad. Now we come to the last point, the transitional form. Do we have transitional? I just want to show you the rare suggested eosinophilic mediated form to invasive. One of the cases you see in the year 1997, very long time, this was the situation of the case. She underwent, unfortunately, external approach with us, one of the doctors. He performed external approach, and you see, then here we are. We had to perform surgery for such a case, and this is the situation, you see. And the year 2000, the situation was relatively okay. The same patient, 1997, and then 2000, you see here, and the bone intact, and it was okay. But you see here the external approach, previous, and then we did the endoscopic approach. And then suddenly, the year 2008, we got this invasive form, indolent form. You see here, this invasive form. Not only this, you see, with fistula down here. Unfortunately, you see here the fistula in the floor, You see, this is the transitional form, one of the cases of transitional form. This is a rare case as well. Allergic fungal sinusitis one side and invasive form on one side. You see allergic here and the invasive up there. This is not a common happening, So we can come to the conclusion. What's our conclusion? Our conclusion is fungal rhinosinusitis, not common. It's not uncommon. And then frequency has been increasing over the past 3 or 4 decades. Classified, non-invasive, and invasive. And we have to put in mind, diagnosis needs a high index of suspicion. You have to suspect this is a fungal. And then immunity should be borne in mind. And then allergic fungal sinusitis, the treatment, complete surgical debridement, drainage, the medical therapy, basically the steroids. And strict follow-up, recurrence should be considered. And then lastly, the acute fulminant type invasive form, we treat the underlying metabolic or immunologic condition, intravenous antifungal therapy, and then wide local resection. Prognosis is definitely should be considered. Before I end, I just want to make sure that everybody does have this book showing the anatomy of the lateral nasal wall, also meta complex and anterior skull base. It's very simple, very easy for everybody to revise in no more than half an hour or even less. And usually I end my story, knowledge is power. This is my email. This is our website. We are adding a lot to our website, inshallah, rhinology@redakamel.com. And this is the flyer of Rhino Egypt, our beloved Rhino Egypt. Inshallah, 27th March 4th to 6th. 2021. إن شاء الله ربنا يدينا صحة وعافية وعمر. السنة الجاية نلتقي إن شاء الله على خير في إن إحنا رينو إيجيبت هتكون العيد بتاعنا برضو ونقدر إن إحنا نحتفل مع بعض في ظروف أجمل وأحسن لكل واحد فينا. أتمنى إن المحاضرة تكون لطيفة وظريفة وعفيفة وشريفة وان احنا ان شاء الله نقدر ان احنا نوصل اللي هو النتيجة الجميلة عشان نقدر ان احنا بإذن الله نبقى دايما موجودين مع بعضنا. انا بالتالي اتمنى بس ان يكون الامور كانت ماشية بطريقة حلوة، واتمنى بس نشوف يا ترى في اسئلة او حاجة دلوقتي، لان اعتقد ان فكرة اللي هي عاوزين نشوف الأسئلة بس عشان الدكتور نقول محمد بس يا ريت يدينا خبر عشان الأسئلة توصل لنا ازاي، بس عشان ايه فاهمين ونقدر نرد على الأسئلة ان شاء الله. ايوه انا بس طب هي فين بس موجوده، معلش فين عشان نبقى واضحين. انا فتحت الموبايل خلاص، ايوه، ودخلت على الايه، على فيرس ايجيبشن اي ان تي ريزنت فورم. ايوه فين الكومنتس بعد اذنك؟ لو لا 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 مش شايفه، لا اتفضل. ايوه النوتيفيكيشن على ال ايوه جيت تو يور بروفايل از في الفيسبوك ولا في ايه؟ انا فتحت الفيسبوك اهوت، ادخل على الجروب بتاعتكم. ما جاليش حاجة. ايوه يور جروب. بتوزع كتاب مجاني، وكمان فعلا بتوزع كتاب مجاني سيستميك انتي فانجل دراجز دهيت، لو بشويش عشان حاجات سريعه جدا. فانجل سينوسايتس الكتاب مش محتاجين ان احنا على فكره ان احنا نجيبه من بره. الكتاب انت لو دخلت على فكره على rhinology@redakamel.com هتلاقي الكتاب، توصل لمجموعه الدكاتره وتقدر انك انت تعمل له داونلود فري اوف تشارج من غير اي حاجه. ده بالنسبه للكتاب. بالنسبه للسيستميك انتي فانجل، هي طبعا مؤكد ان السيستميك انتي فانجل لهم باد افكتس هيباتيك ورينال وبلاد، وعشان كده للاسف مش احنا طبعا اللي بنديهم، اللي بيدوهم هم دكاتره الهيماتولوجي، وهم اللي حقيقي بيقدروا ان هم يعملوا تظبيط للجرعه اللي بيقللوا او يزودوا، وطبعا دي مش تخرج عن قدراتنا احنا في حاجه زي كده. طبعا هي حقيقه يعني، اسامه بيصار جميل بيقول اتس دايليما، حقيقه يعني في المانجمنت وفي التريتمنت. في التريتمنت هي طبعا الفكره ان يا ترى الاكيو اللي هو الاكيوت انفيزي بيتحول لكرونيك. هو طبعا ما فيش سيد، هي طبعا الفكره ان يا ترى الاكيو اللي هو فبالطريقه دي اكيوت انفيزي بيتحول لكرونيك. ف هو طبعا ما فيش سيد، هي طبعا فما فيش نقدر نقول حاجه زي كده، ومش ريبورتد ان الاكيوت انفيزيف يتحول لكرونيك انفيزيف. هو الالرجيك فانجل سينوسايتس ممكن ان هو يبقى يتحول الى كرونيك ايدلون تايب جرانيولوما. جرانيولوما دي اللي احنا بنشوفها. ادير انتي فانجل سبراي، لا ما فيش انتي فانجل سبراي، لكن احنا فاهمين ان في انتي فانجل ووش. هو كان في انتي فانجل سبراي ظهر فجاه وفتره واختفى، لانه لما كان في ثيوري بتقول ان كل حالات الكرونيك راينوسينوسايتس كلها عباره عن نقول فانجل اوريجين، which is not true حقيقي. What's the difference between chronic invasive fungal rhinosinusitis and chronic؟ احنا قلناها، هو الكرونيك نقول invasive fungal rhinosinusitis وchronic invasive granulomatous fungal rhinosinusitis الفرق ما بينهم كبير جدا. هو الكرونيك انفيزيف العادي خالص هو نفسه الاكيوت انفيزيف الاسود ده، والجنجرين ده والكلام ده كله والنيوروفاسكولار هو هو بس هو سلو عشان في واحد يا اما اميون كومبتنت يا اما اميون نقول كومبرومايز بسيط خالص مش ديتكتبل في معظم الحالات غير بقى اللي هو جرانيلوما. جرانيلوما ده نوع تاني خالص ده عباره عن نان نيكروتايزنج نقول او كيزيتنج نقول الجرانيلوما ده عباره احمر وبعدين بيبقى كيزيتنج عباره عن زي كارتلج بالظبط بتقطعها بطريقه مش جميله. في اللي هو هي برضو بقول is there any staging for acute invasive rhinosinusitis. هي الستيجنج مش staging هي برضو مش ميكور مايكوزيس خلاص ما بقاش اسمه ميكور مايكوزيس عشان احنا فاهمين ان هو مش ميكور مايكوزيس بس ده هم ممكن يكون ميكور او اسبرجيلوزيس. طيب هل في staging؟ هو الستيجنج مش حقيقة هو الستيجنج بنشوفه احنا بقى بالذات في الميكوزا من البيل لليلو لل نقول البراون للبلاك للالسريشن للنكروزيس للكراس هو ده الستيجز. كل ما الواحد يلقطها بدري السي تي ممكن نقول السي تي مينيمال ديزيز او الاجريسيف ديزيز. واحد بيقول ان المحاضره لطيفه ظريفه عفيفه شريفه. اتمنى ان فعلا كل واحد لقى المحاضره لطيفه ظريفه عفيفه شريفه. البوست اوبريتيف فولو اب ده سؤال جميل سؤال جميل خالص خالص من دكتور اسامه. سؤال جميل لان البوست اوبريتيف كير هو حاجه زي مثلا نقول الفانجل بول هتشوفه 6 شهور سنه ماكسيمم مخف خلاص. الاليرجيك فانجل سينوسايتس هتشوفه طول العمر. الاكيوت فالمن دوت هتشوفه يومين او اسبوع يا مات عايش. الكرونيك اندلان ده عيان بيعيش معاك فتره طويله حقيقي بتبقى عايش معاه باد ستوري باد ستوري لو هو خرج عن اطار القدره. هو في كتاب تاني في كتاب اللي هو لو تقدر تنزله من الويب سايت اللي هو كاديفر ديسكشن جايد وده حاجه جميله ممكن انك انت لما تيجي تعمل كاديفر ديسكشن في اي كورس ممكن انك انت تنزله. بالنسبه to the use of the steroids usually we use the post operative steroid طبعا systemic for 2 weeks maximum 3 weeks في معظم الحالات low dose ما بستخدمش حتى half milligram يمكن 15 milligram per day ثلاث اقراص بعد الفطار 5 milligram كل واحد وان انا اقدر ان انا اخليه ياخده بعد كده الى اللوكال. طبعا احنا واضحين وفاهمين وعارفين ان الايام دي اوعى تعمل عمليه فيس لعيان الا لو كان لا قدر الله كومبليكيتد اوربيتال او كرينيال. النهارده فاهمين ان حاله الفيس دي من اخطر ما يمكن في الكوفيد 19 او الكورونا فيروس. احنا عملنا امبارح نقول محاضره يمكن اتاخرنا فيها شويه بس طبعا نقول حضرها مئات الناس عدد كبير من مصر وبره مصر ومن تخصصات كبيره جدا غير الانف واذن وحنجره. واللي كنت عاوز اقوله وكنا واضحين جدا مش هيبقى في عمليات لا لوز ولا كلام في احرام. انت بتعرض الطفل لان هو يجيله الكوفيد وانت اصلا بقى خلي بالك ان الطفل دوت هو اكتر واحد كارينج الاطفال نفس الانفكشن الكبير والصغير والتقين والرفيع بيجيله اللي هو الايه الانفكشن بس عدد قليل اللي بيبان عليه واللي بيبان عليه بقى ممكن ايه يوصل لمراحل متاخره الكبير. الطفل الصغير هو حامل الميكروب ممكن جدا عملت له العمليه انت شلت الميكروب الاوحش من كده هو الفيروس ان هو بقى هو داخل في كاسكيد يتقال انك انت سبب المشاكل اللي جات له. فعشان كده انت لازم مش هتعمل عمليه الا لو كانت هايلي انديكيتد في كومبليكيشن في مالجنسي في تراكيوس مجبر وتبقى واخد كل فول بروتكشن 95 اتليست والكاب بتاعتك والشيل بتاعك وجوجل بتاعك والماسك ممكن ماسكين وبعدين طبعا الايه الابرون بتاعك اللي هو الجاون بتاعك لازم يكون ايه كامل بيكون طبعا ووتر بروف ما ينفعش انه يكون قماش وبعدين جوانتي اتنين جوانتي على الاقل والاوفر شوز وانت اقل وقت ممكن للعمليه واوعى تستخدم الشيفر اوعى تستخدم الشيفر اوعى تستخدم الشيفر ولا الدريل ده ايريسول هيطلع لك يعني نسبه العدوى بتاعت كل الناس زي بتاعت البيتيوتري عمل 14 واحد جوه وبره الاوضه اتعدوا. فعشان كده اوعى تعمل عمليه فيست الايام دي، وطبعا بالتالي مش تدي بوست اوبرتيف كورتيزون، لان طبعا ممنوع ندي كورتيزون في الفتره الحاليه، احنا في فتره حقيقي خطيره جدا، فلازم ان احنا نبقى حريصين عنها بالذات. طبعا لو في نيكروتيك كريبري فورم بليت مع حاله نقول اكوت انفيزيف، انت مضطر تشيلها، مضطر تشيلها غالبا الديوره بتبقى لسه انت. لو معديه بقى خلاص، هو فانجل ديبرس، خلاص لو معديه بقى الكرينيال كافيتي ستوب بقى. لكن لو يعني لازم انك انت وانت معتمد على الانتي فانجل، لا تتوقع ان العيان ده ابدا هتلاقيه نقول دخل برين ودخل نقول اوربت، انت ده الاداه داك للاسف. The use of doxycycline in allergic fungal rhinosinusitis with polyps. هو دوكسي ماشي chronic rhinosinusitis with polyps. لكن allergic fungal rhinosinusitis with polyps ما فيش good evidence to support إلا لو كان في associated itis معها. لأن هو allergic fungal rhinosinusitis is quite different عن chronic rhinosinusitis with polyps. Two different categories. ده فكرة وده فكرة. ده ألرجي قد يكون نسبة كبيرة، ده ألرجي نسبة محدودة جدا. في واحد بيقول لي احنا راضين عليك، والله كتر خيرك جدا جدا، وأجمل ما هو قال ان هو راضي، مش رضا عادي، رضا كامل يعني، راسه وعينه، knowledge is power. طبعا يا رب دي knowledge is power. طبعا together we can make a big difference, together we are stronger. يعني حقيقي اتمنى بس يمكن الوقت بقى طبعا يكون خلاص. دكتور عمر قول لي بقى ان احنا نقف امتى عشان بس ايه نتمنى ان يكون المحاضره لطيفه ظريفه عفيفه شريفه، ما يكونش ان في صورتي انا تكبر على الشاشه. انا هقول لك بقى امانه، انا عاوز صوره راينو ايجيبت تتكبر على الشاشه، يعني عشان انا الروح بتاعتي هي راينو ايجيبت. How to differentiate between سؤال جميل. How to differentiate between ده سؤال جميل جدا. Between granulomatous fungal rhinosinusitis and malignancy. لا طبعا ده سؤال من أجمل الأسئلة اللي نقول شفناها. هي ايه؟ هي ان البيوبسي، هي اهم حاجه ممكن ان احنا نوصل لها اعتقد. ايوه خلاص. انا بالمنظر ده انا اعتقد ان الامور كده عدينا عدد كبير من الاسئله. وطبعا لو في حد عنده اي اسئله طبعا عندكم البيرسونال ايميل بتاعنا والتليفون. لكن anyhow انا بس بقول يا رب تكون المحاضره لطيفه ظريفه عفيفه شريفه، واتمنى ان يكون كانت مفيده لينا كلنا. وطبعا بشكر حقيقي مره ثانيه الدكتور علاء البحيري على الاستضافه. بشكر فريق كفر الشيخ الشباب الصاعد حقيقي فردا فردا بدون تسميه، لكن كلهم مجموعه جميله بنكني ليها كل الحب والتقدير والاحترام. واحنا كراين ايجيبت احنا طبعا داعمين ليكم دعم شديد، ودايما بقول together we are stronger, together we can make a big difference. حقيقي بشكركم وبتمنى لكم كل التوفيق، وبتمنى للي هما داخلين امتحانات يكونوا استفادوا. بتمنى لكل اي دكتور بيمارس المهنه وبيشتغل في نقول الراينولوجي يكون استفاد من اللي احنا قلناه. شكرا لكم واهلا بكم، واتمنى المحاضره تكون لطيفه ظريفه عفيفه وشريفه. شكرا لكم.